This is Ham Radio Now, episode 282 already. And it is also EmComm Extra number 4, which means I need to bring in this guy, Dan Goldenberg, W0DHT. Hey, Dan, how you doing?
Good. How are you doing, Gary?
Good. Have a good Thanksgiving?
Yeah, we did. We did. How about yourself?
Excellent. Oh, I haven't given the title for the show, so we can bring that thing in. It is SKYWARN Recognition Day. So there's the title. Episode 284, and we have a guest with us. Let me bring that guy on here. It is Dan Noah, who works for NOAA. This is going to be confusing, Dan. You are WX4DAN. You are the Warnings Coordination Meteorologist. Did I get all the S's in the right place? Warnings Coordination Meteorologist.
Yep, just warning.
Warning coordination.
Singular.
Okay. So you only coordinate one warning at a time.
That's right.
Yeah. And you work for the Tampa Bay National Weather Service office.
I do. I've been down here for 14 years. Prior to that, I was in Bismarck, North Dakota for 9 years.
Oh, that's going to be different.
Yeah, the SKYWARN programs are completely different from North Dakota to Florida.
Well, I mean, just the weather. I mean, how long did it take for the ice to finish melting?
Well, some years, and I grew up in northern Minnesota, so it's not a stretch for me to be in Bismarck. But we'd have snow on the ground before Halloween, and it wouldn't go away until late April.
Yeah, and things are seriously different in Tampa, I would imagine.
And hail was very common in North Dakota. Every storm had hail, and so the spotters up there would only report if it was a 3/4 inch hail or larger. But down here in Florida, we don't get as much hail, so if they see pea-sized hail, we still want them to call.
Okay.
Yeah, that's how it works for us in Los Angeles. I'm a SKYWARN spotter, and if we see any hail at all, they're asking us to report in.
Hail seems to be the deal. We'll talk about how the SKYWARN thing works in a little bit. I was just down in Tampa in September. The Tapper group that I do the video for had their conference. It was actually across the bay in St. Petersburg, mm-hmm. but my first time to get down in that territory. So SKYWARN Recognition Day. Let me bring up the website for this thing here. This is the official National Weather Service website. It's coming up this Saturday from 0000 Zulu to 2400 Zulu. I am Zulu challenged.
That's, me too.
That is
7 p.m. Friday.
So Friday, okay, because I couldn't
7 p.m. Eastern time Friday.
Whenever I do anything, and a lot of people do anything that is going to be at the stroke of midnight, it becomes ambiguous as to which day. So I'm always 0001 or something like that, 1201. Okay, so 7 p.m. Friday Eastern time, 7654, 4 o'clock out where you are, David.
Right.
So, so you guys can participate on your commute home.
That's yeah, we right, would so. Be able to.
And let me go back to the website. It's going to be a big deal. These are all the National Weather Service offices that are going to be part of it, including one down here in Hawaii and one up in Alaska. So it's a pretty big deal. Dan, do you remember how long this has been going on?
It started in 1999, and it's been going on as a special event every year since then.
And what's the goal? What's the purpose?
Maybe amateur radio operators have been the backbone of SKYWARN program for decades. And this is sort of a fun event to recognize their efforts. And if on Friday evening or Saturday you contact us in our office, you will get this nice QSL card, Whiskey X-Ray 4 TOR, and we will mail it to you. So not all offices are going to send out QSL cards, but we like to, and just try to contact as many Weather Service offices as you can. The more you contact, the higher ranking you get.
A ranking in what? What is it?
They have different like award levels. It's just bragging rights.
Okay, so is it like Field Day? It's a contest. That's not a contest.
Yeah. Exactly. Yes.
Okay. And it's also not training.
It is not training. It's just a day to have fun. If you go to the website, hamradio.noaa.gov, of. You can find out which modes every office is working in. So we've got, you know, VHF, UHF, and HF, as well as EchoLink. And you can find out if, you know, are they using packet radio or what they're doing. So you just try to contact as many offices as you can throughout the day.
Okay.
So, for the event, are you bringing other hams in, or is it all the equipment that you already have set up at those offices?
Well, most offices have ham equipment set up already. We're fortunate here in south of Tampa. We live next to Sun City Center, which is a retirement community. There's actually two ham clubs there, and we get a lot of support from them. And we'll set up in the conference room, though, and rather than operations, just so we can spread out a little bit. And we invite all the local amateur radio operators to come into the office. You can get a quick tour, look around, and see how all this works.
So you are opening the offices as well, or at least the ones listed here?
Yes, we are opening up the office for people to come in and work the radios, and it gets pretty busy sometimes.
Yeah, so I'm looking at you guys now on the web. So you guys are going to be on all bands 80 through 70 centimeters, except 220, sideband FM, and on EchoLink.
Right.
And so, and it looks like a lot of the offices will be Springfield. Doesn't say what state. Only on 2 meters. That must be the Springfield that Homer Simpson is in, because we don't know what state that is. All right, so it could be just about any band, and just work as many as you can, and
absolutely
qualify for recognition. I guess I'm wondering what SKYWARN needs to get recognized for. I think everybody knows it exists. Is there enough participation, though? I mean, the hams really dig into it.
You know, the people that like to do contests, of course, are very aggressive in contacting as many offices as possible. We let people know what frequency we're on, so they don't have to search all over the bands for us. And I only have a technician's license, so I'm not sure what software is used to do that. But I've been a ham for about 20 years, and it's just a good group of people to hang out and eat some junk food and talk on the radio.
So you guys will get spotted, I guess, on the clusters. All right.
Yes.
So I wonder if we shouldn't talk a little bit or ask Dan to talk a little bit about what is the mission. I know it's kind of varies from state to state, and probably right now in like Tennessee, where they're having the tornadoes, it's probably a little more active.
Yeah, it's SKYWARN is different in each part of the country. There's 122 local weather service offices, and each one runs their SKYWARN program that fits their local area. So when I was in North Dakota, we would call the hams in for every severe weather event. Now I'm in Florida, and every day in the summer we get rain and pulse severe thunderstorms. So we pretty much call in our hams for tropical events. And it was a good thing we did that during 2004 Hurricane Charley, because we lost all communications with the Emergency Operations Center in Punta Gorda, and ham radio was the only way we could talk to them for 2 hours.
Oh, we love hearing stories like that, when ham radio actually does what we say it does, which is work. Absolutely. When everything else fails. So that was an example of something that actually worked.
Yeah, it worked very well. It was good to have them here. You get a little anxious when you can't talk to the emergency management.
Yeah. So were you participating, or were you present when that communication happened?
No, I was actually in the Fort Myers Emergency Operations Center at that time. And Charlie was actually wobbled, and it was coming right for Fort Myers. And then it jogged back to the left and went to Punta Gorda, north.
So you got the story after that happened, but people told you that that ham radio basically filled in. How long a time did that happen?
About 2 hours.
That's a long time.
It is. And, you know, back then, cell phone towers didn't have backup power. So they, you know, all cell phone towers lost communications. It was very interesting. In fact, even our weather observations started dropping off the map. And that's when you know the hurricane's bad, is when it starts destroying all the automated systems and the maps start to go dark.
No. So I was going to ask how centralized or how independent the operations are in terms of how the nets are run, what the criterion of information that you are asking for is. Do you get dictated how that's going to work, or how the SKYWARN program works, or do you get to decide?
We get to decide locally. We work with the local amateur radio operators, and we decide what works best for our area. And so every program's a little different. Some offices actually issue IDs and ID cards. Others don't. We do, and we put all of the spotters in a database. And then when we have a warning go out, the little polygons, every person that lives inside that polygon, we can send out a blast email and ask for reports even after the event. So we value our spotters. They're half of our warning program. That's the only reason we issue warnings, is if radar strongly suggests it, or if one of our trained SKYWARN spotters report it.
SKYWARN is not strictly a ham radio operation, right?
No, in fact, citizen emergency response teams are getting involved now, and also the general public. We have a lot of people that are interested in weather. And they tell us, oh, I wish I would have went into the weather field. And it's just a great way for them to experience their passion and help their fellow neighbors.
So down where you are, how do you recruit members? I know in our area, they Joe Sherrard is our local meteorologist, and he comes every other year or so to our Aries meetings and some of the other groups. But how do you recruit and gain members?
Well, we have what we call a storm ready recognition program for cities and counties and large businesses. And one of the requirements is to have a SKYWARN training. So we're reaching people that we've never reached in the past. The city public information officer can send out blast emails to employees and advertise in the newspaper about these trainings. So we do here in West Central Florida, we probably do about 29 SKYWARN trainings a year and to about 750 people.
Okay, and then you list them on there, and then, like you said, you guys do call-ups. We typically, we get activated through our local DEC when we've done, you know, the spotting we do. And typically here it's, you know, heavy rainstorm or hail.
And we also, since we don't have the hams come in for our daily wet season storms, what we have done is we work with the amateur radio operators like Aries or Racies that work with emergency management. We give them access to our secure chat room server that we use with emergency management and the media, and they relay reports that way back to our office.
Okay. Yeah, we operate differently, and I guess, as you said, that every different is it based on your stations or localities? I guess they do their own specific training.
It's really based on the type of weather you get and your demographics. So down here in Florida, you can't chase storms in a metro area, so we don't teach that. And most of our SKYWARN spotters, you know, it's a retirement state. They're, you know, over the age of 65. And so we're more about, after the storm has passed, report to us what you have seen, if it matches the criteria. Whereas in the plain states, you got to teach spotters how to view the storm safely because you don't want them to get, like, in the forward flank downdraft and have the tornado coming at them. They can't see it. It's just too dangerous.
Yeah, I hadn't thought about asking about this, but now it occurs to me, how does SKYWARN and storm chasing, how do they work together or
we
not?
We don't teach people to chase storms, but we teach them to view the storms safely. And that involves, you know, positioning and storm movement and what to look for. So when I was in Bismarck, we would teach much more of the advanced SKYWARN training than we do here in Florida. In fact, in Florida, the advanced training is online now, and we replaced it with a hurricane training. So we do the basic SKYWARN training and then the hurricane training for here.
About how long is the program, or both of the programs?
It's about an hour and a half. It used to be 3 hours, and then I just was looking at the body language, and people looked exhausted. So it's nice, short, and sweet. We give them resources like a booklet and additional web links to get further information that they can do self-paced training after the in-person training.
They've done SKYWARN training at radio club meetings around here. And a typical radio club that might get 20, 30, 40 people will have over 100 when they do a SKYWARN training.
Exactly. So
very popular.
I think the largest one I've done is 405.
Yep. So I was going to, well, let me follow up on the storm chasing, because storm chasing is a big deal. And my car is full of antennas. It's got a computer and stuff sitting on there. The number one question I get at gas stations or whenever people see me where they can talk to me is, are you a storm chaser? So there's a lot of interest in that. I'm in North Carolina. You can't chase storms here either because you're no more than a couple hundred yards from a stand of 70-foot pine trees.
Right.
The storms chase you. But
exactly.
Is there any integration between storm chasers and SKYWARN out in the plains where you can do that sort of stuff? Do they participate in the SKYWARN as they're out there chasing, not on your behalf, but they're going to see things?
Yeah, they will report it in. And what's interesting is the Weather Service, universities, storm chasers, and the media developed a nonprofit group, spotternetwork.org. And that was an attempt to have advanced training and have an app with your phone so that we can track you while you're chasing the storm. And if you're near a storm we're interested in, we can click on your dot and call you. So it's kind of a SKYWARN for smartphones. And with a, you know, the smartphones are, everybody has one now. We are getting so many, much more pictures and video than we ever have in the past.
Okay, so that's sort of outside the ham radio realm, but hams are welcome to do that, I guess.
Well, and a lot of hams actually will be members of that as well. And then it's they can even have live video, some of the people. But that all goes back to communications and with amateur radio, when bad weather happens, that's sometimes all the communication we have is with amateur radio.
On the recognition day, a lot of the Weather Service offices are going to have HF stations. But is there any HF activity typically in SKYWARN activations, or is it around here just about all on 2 meter repeaters?
It's mostly, 2 meter. But, you know, the national centers, like the Hurricane Center, will run HF within a landfalling hurricane and take reports directly to them. But for the local areas, it's mostly going to be 2 meter. Our backbone is 70 centimeters on our NI4CE repeater system that connects the area together. And
yeah, I got to play with that when I was driving through. That was very cool. I remember that call sign. Is there anything besides voice in use on ham radio? You're doing text and other stuff on the internet, which is subject to
we
fail.
We have a packet radio that we're using. We have to reset up our system. We had a change in operations. But it's mostly voice, and they'll gather the reports, the net control operator, and share it with the operation. So they're right next to us in operations. And we might say, hey, we're really interested in that storm 10 miles north of Tampa. Could you see if anybody's out there? And they'll go fish for reports. And it's very helpful.
One of the things that has concerned me all the time that I've been participating in SKYWARN here in North Carolina is they've got a good operation going, but there's not enough hams out there. We have the ham radio density. There's hams just about every place around the area that could be watching. But when a call goes out from the Weather Service office, is anyone observing this storm? We're seeing something we'd like some ground reports on. It's pretty rare that there's a ham anywhere nearby that's on the net. That concerns me. And I'm wondering if you guys are seeing that sort of thing, or if there's other areas that just get the participation that they're looking for.
Well, we're pretty highly density population along the coast. It's when we get into interior Florida where it's very rural, that is, we have such a lack of reports from our rural counties, and it's a struggle. We'll find out about damage maybe a month later sometimes, and that's just, it's too late. So if nobody reports it, we can't document it, and it doesn't end up in our storm database.
Okay, so it does sound like you need more participation, and probably I'm going to guess at just about every place. David, how is it out there?
Well, we do the training at least once a year, every other year, with our members, and then we activate maybe once a year, once every other year. Typically, when we have a big rainstorm come through, we don't go chasing. Absolutely not. We're against all that. It's all, you know, your home or you're at your office. What's the weather like? They ask for us to report hail, lightning, or velocity of rain over a certain amount. I think it's like an inch an hour in the Los Angeles area. And so, you know, most people go get a good, nice rain gauge, and we'll report in those activities. I know we did an update of the database recently, and Joe sent out some automated emails, and I got a phone call on my cell phone that I have registered with them, asking them, are we still interested in participating? It's not as much activity here as you probably have, you know, down there or you know, through Hurricane Alley for sure.
Yeah, we get pretty busy in tornado season. And, you know, North Carolina gets the best of both. We get lots of tornadoes and the hurricane every now and then. Florida, not so much on tornadoes, or do you get some?
Well, surprisingly, Florida is number 10 for states with the most tornadoes. Texas is number one, but that's a big state compared to the size of Florida. But fortunately for us, we average 52 a year. A lot of them are water spouts that come on shore, and then we call it a tornado, and it dissipates after a few hundred yards.
All right. Well, I was asking if you're decentralized in terms of organization, and it sounds like you're pretty much autonomous, but I imagine that there's still some talk that goes from one office to another from guys in your position and the hams in the ham EC positions from one area to another, talking about how this is how we do it here. How do you do it there? That kind of communication goes on much?
Oh, absolutely. And in Florida, even in Florida, we do it differently from office to office, but we'll oftentimes get reports for somebody else's forecast area, and then we'll contact that office to inform them of what's going on. We have a lot of amateur radio operators that live on the border up in the villages in Florida. They live three separate forecast offices forecast for that city. And so we share a lot of those reports with our surrounding offices.
Okay. So maybe we've convinced a ham who's not participated in their local SKYWARN operation that they ought to. How do they find you? What do they do? How do they get started?
The easiest way is to just go to weather.gov, weather.gov, and look for the U.S. map and click on where you live. And that your local weather service forecast office will pop up. Scroll to the bottom of the page and click on the SKYWARN icon. And you'll see all the information about the local program.
Okay, I'm going to try to do that, and that's always dangerous here. Okay, so I'm at weather.gov. And now what am I looking for?
You're going to click on the U.S. map on where you live.
Okay, so let's see. I'll be in North Carolina. Happened to hit my office.
And then scroll down and look for the SKYWARN icon.
Okay. Ah, there's the familiar icon.
Okay. And then you can learn about how SKYWARN works in your neighborhood.
Yeah, Central Carolina SKYWARN, Triad SKYWARN are the folks around here. And if I dug into this hard enough, I would probably find some links to contact people.
Yes, and then like our SKYWARN webpage, it gives all the different frequencies that the different clubs use during SKYWARN operations. Also links to those clubs in case somebody wants to join. With the citizen emergency response teams, a lot of them are becoming hams as well, and are looking to not only just do weather, but also amateur radio.
Okay. So how do you get that traffic in? We'll do a net, and I often wondered, is there a ham that's in your facility monitoring the net, or is our net control operator passing the traffic over phone or other?
Well, here in our office, since we don't have the hams, they only come during tropical events. 11 of the 14 meteorologists got their ticket. The local ham club provided the training.
Wow.
And so they can do net control. But just to keep everybody up to date, we do a weekly net every Tuesday at 9 p.m. We'll do the net, and then we'll have a question and answer session after the net.
Yeah, we do that here too. There's a SKYWARN net every week. So I guess that's another way to keep people active and interested. This is the Central Carolina SKYWARN. So I'll give a shout out to Virginia NC4VA. She's our SKYWARN EC for Central Carolina SKYWARN. And here you guys are again promoting SKYWARN Recognition Day, and there'll be a big operation going on there starting on Friday. So they don't have an HF station permanently at our location, so they'll be running across the roof, stringing dipoles and stuff, getting things set up.
I think that's what'll happen in our local, our local office is Oxnard. I think that's what they do, is the Conejo Valley group goes up there and sets up.
Yeah. But they do have good VHF and UHF coverage. I always ask these days for any kind of EmComm, as we're being proliferated with more digital voice modes, do you guys do anything like that, or is that still a little bit too far out there?
That's too, a little bit beyond our capabilities right now. What we have in place now seems to work. And I know the hams have always said, hey, we got this. But, you know, we have limited resources like all agencies do, and we have to focus on getting the biggest bang for the buck.
David, I'm seeing a trend forming here on those digital modes.
Yep.
And we're going to
still try it. Yeah. I'm going to keep on trying though, Gary.
We're going to hear from the folks who have succeeded in incorporating a digital mode of some form. I'm talking about the digital voice modes, the D-Star, DMR, Turbo, Yaesu System Fusion, even maybe P25. We're going to hear from somebody who's going to catch the show and say, well, no, we're using that. It works, but it's the system confusion that I'll talk about right now. It still makes it hard for any one organization to pick. You got to pick one, and hams are going to have a hard time doing that. They've all got FM.
Yeah. And we're still doing the digital stuff. We're going to do is all going to be on FM, the FLDigi, and the NBeam stuff is what we're kind of pushing. And actually some of the groups that I've gone and done trainings for, they're actually picking up using it. The Sheriff's Department in LA County is actually doing a weekly nets and using that for some of their deployments.
Yeah.
Not so much the D-Star and it's just too hard. There are too many, you know, divergent technologies out there.
And I was thinking the SKYWARN data that is pretty tactical. It can go pretty quickly on voice, but it could probably go even better if everybody had a little form that says exactly where. Well, the GPS will fill out the where, and the form would be the what, and zip it right in. I mean, you guys take text messages and emails and stuff from the general public and from the cert groups, right, Dan?
Oh, that would be great. Especially we love pictures and geotagged information.
Yeah. I mean, you get that from the general public already. Do you accept text messages or emails?
Well, we tell people to use Twitter or post on our Facebook page. Our hashtag is FLWX or WXFL, and it's a good way, except for we find there are some bad sports out there that try to send in fake pictures and put it off as real. So we have to really do some quality control checking of some of the images that are coming in.
Yeah, hopefully they don't get smart enough to send you something that's right on the edge of believable. They just send you wacky stuff, and you can easily tell.
Exactly. You know, we issued one warning for Tampa, and they said, "Oh, here's a picture of the tornado." And I'm going, "Well, no, that's the water spout that came on shore 3 years ago. I was working that event, and that's not true."
there's the occasional ham who has that problem as well. They so desperately want to get in on the action that they'll make something up, and you probably put more credibility into a ham's report. So,
oh, absolutely.
Once again, if the ones that I've heard of around here, and they're very rare, but they do happen, is somebody who's seeing something nobody else is seeing and the radar's not seeing. And
if Joe Public calls with a report of a tornado, we will try to call one of our SKYWARN spotters, local law enforcement, the emergency manager, to try to verify it. Because we have a lot of things in Florida that look like funnels and tornadoes that just aren't. They're just a funny looking cloud.
Well, and that's part of what the training is all about. Do you guys issue numbers so that if somebody is giving you a report, they give you a spotter number and you know that they've been trained to a certain level?
Yes. In fact, they'll give us their SKYWARN spotter number, and that way we document that. And then we know they've been through the training, and some people are more active than others, and it really gives us a confidence level in that report.
All right. So we've showed people where to go and how to participate. But I guess let's add one more detailed element. And if I'm checking in and I've or monitoring the net and there's weather moving through my area, what am I going to expect to hear? Now, it is going to be different for each area, and it depends on the weather event. But let's say it's a tornado, which is maybe one of the most common and scary versions of bad weather that you guys out there don't see, David. Sorry.
Right.
So there's tornado warnings going on, and I'm looking at, an awesome dark sky. How's my participation in SKYWARN going to be? Give me a little step by step.
Well, down when I was in Bismarck, North Dakota, we would have net control, and we'd operate on a certain networks, and people knew to monitor those networks. And when they had a report, we would talk every so often to update people on where the bad storms are. And then people would report back. Down here, the hams that work with emergency management are the net control operators, and they do it county by county, typically, for the daily events. And then when we have tropical events, we use the linked repeaters, and the hams know which frequencies to listen to, and it's also on our website.
All right. But if I'm the individual now, it's time for me to check in. And maybe I've never done this before. I'm probably going to be a little bit nervous. What do they want me to do? And what do they want me to say?
We want you to know the criteria to report. We don't report heavy rain. But if it's impeding traffic or it's starting to flood homes and businesses, we want to hear from you. And so you can either go through amateur radio or you can call the 800 number, and we want the time, event, and location. So you can say, at 4 p.m., I was 10 miles north of Tampa on this highway, and I experienced a quarter-inch hail. So time, event, location, very important. And we'd rather you use the time on your cell phone rather than, if you're at work, at the clock on the wall, because those can be plus or minus 5 minutes of the real time, and that's a big difference in radar time.
So, and we do something kind of similar to that, Gary, here. When we're asked to activate, we'll just spin up a regular net like we would for any other, event, the Aries event, because we typically run the SKYWARN nets through the Aries process. So get on the link repeaters and, we'll do a head count. We'll do a roll call to see who is available. And we'll collect the SKYWARN spotter numbers as well as, your call sign. And then as activity happens, you see the heavy rain or the hail or thunder and lightning, then they'll report it into the net, flooding, water accumulation, so on and so forth. And we do have an occasional tornado here, but usually, it rips the roof off of a market and then it's gone.
Yeah.
And but very few and far between.
All right. And if you take the training, you're probably going to get this kind of information. So.
Yep.
So we would like everybody to have the training, but if you haven't had it yet, I guess most nets will still accept some information from you, but if you've got no number, they're going to discount the validity until they get some verification.
Yeah. So if we get a report of a tornado and we look at radar and we see rotation, we may pull the trigger on that tornado warning, even if it's a public report.
And all of our reports go through one of our, seasoned net control operators. And then I think then they have a conversation with the NOAA folks. So I think, it gets somewhat filtered out. Again, like you said, if you don't have a spotter number or the report that you're giving, you're getting 4 inches of rain in an hour. We don't ever get that here. It's always suspect. And they may ask another operator that's in the local vicinity, what are you seeing?
So we get a lot of reports of funnel clouds, especially in the evening in Florida during the wet season. So we spend an awful lot of time showing, is this a funnel, tornado, or a funny looking cloud? And we'll go over lots of different examples of this because there are some things that really look like tornadoes that aren't.
Now, you remember this from your Bismarck days, and not so much from Tampa, but summer weather, tornadoes, hurricanes, things like that, are not all that get reported. There's winter stuff, too.
Well, that's right. In fact, Bismarck just had a foot and a half of snow, and those snowfall reports are, you know, ongoing during the event are very important, not only to emergency management, but to really bring home the fact that, hey, don't go driving on the interstate. Hopefully the interstate was closed, but it's really, especially at the beginning of the event, getting those reports are critical to communicate the message that, yes, it's getting dangerous out there.
David, it's 73 degrees here in North Carolina today. It's a little warmer than it usually is. I imagine it's pretty nice where you are. Can you relate to a foot of snow at this point in the year?
No, actually, you know, when I left at my house this morning, it was 38 degrees.
Wow.
I'm kind of in the coldest part of the Los Angeles area.
You're in a mountain town?
No, it's just we're just kind of up against hills, and we don't get a lot of circulation. The city, Woodland Hills, that I live in is we're the coldest during the winter and the hottest during the summer. So we'll go 38. We have freezing mornings occasionally, and then when we get to the summertime, we'll have 118, 120. So it's cold today. I still can't get my head around a foot of snow, but you really never can here.
Yeah, we'll get snow here in North Carolina, but it's not going to start mostly until January, and we don't get very much, and it melts pretty quick.
The last time Tampa had snow was in 1977.
It had snow?
It had a trace of snow at the university.
In 1990, the year I got married, we were in Orlando at Disney World over the Christmas break, and we had snowfall there for 5 minutes. It was fun.
Oh, yeah.
If you were at Disney, that was probably fake.
No, it was real. And, you know, they had all sorts of problems, too, because they had power outages and everybody. Yes. We were staying on one of the properties, and everybody was asking for extra blankets because you just can't keep those places warm enough.
The northern part of Florida, though, northern part of Florida is more susceptible to four-season weather, isn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
Panhandle and Jacksonville.
Florida has four climate regimes, and it varies greatly from North Florida to the Keys.
Yeah, I was so provincial when I lived in Chicago. I didn't know when I moved to North Carolina what the seasons were going to be like. We have snow here. It gets cold. Not as cold as Chicago, but it does get cold. So
we'd like some of that cold air.
Yeah, well, you're not going to get much at any point, but you'll get maybe a little. So I guess the thing is, besides the recognition day, is to utilize that recognition to get more and more hams participating. You could really use a more mass migration of hams into some version of SKYWARN participation. Sounds like just about every place.
Absolutely. We want to, you know, jack up the energy to get people excited about SKYWARN and the weather and using their amateur radio skills, with the end goal is to protect life and property.
All right, and that begins this Friday at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, 0000 Zulu. This is a purely United States deal, right? It's nothing SKYWARN outside of U.S.?
I think some of the Canadians have localized groups that do this, but it's mainly a U.S. We have the most severe weather-prone country in the world.
Really?
And unfortunately, we have too many opportunities to do this.
Well, because we're fairly big, although, you know, there's a few other big countries that you'd think would have weather
has
zones.
A lot of hail, but the tornado capital of the world is in the central plains and southern plains, and this time of year it shifts over to where we saw last night. We had 5 fatalities in Alabama, tornadoes in Mississippi and Tennessee. So we have a lot of active weather, and if people aren't prepared, they can get into harm's way. Right. And SKYWARN is a way to get real report and put them in our warnings to say, yes, this is happening. It's coming towards you. Seek shelter.
Okay. And these days, the amateur radio component of it is an association between NOAA and the ARRL. It operates under ARRES banner just about every place. Wasn't always the case.
Special event.
Yeah, wasn't always the case when it first got started. Do you have any idea what the history is for SKYWARN itself?
I believe in 1965, the first formal SKYWARN training was in Kansas. I forget the city. But that was after a series of bad tornadoes and people say, we got to do something.
Yeah.
Before that, I believe there were spotters that would report lightning to the military so they could cease their operations that are critical, okay, that they don't want to get struck by lightning.
So
that kind of morphed.
My memory of doing a SKYWARN net on a repeater in Chicago, actually sitting in my car outside of work as tornado warnings were in the area, and using an auto patch, because there was no cell phones, to phone in the reports that I was collecting to the Weather Service office on a phone number that I got, and I don't remember how I got it. And I think we called it SKYWARN, so my memory could be pretty good about that. Could really have happened.
And, yeah, you develop a relationship with your local office, and they'll give you the special number to call. And really, you know, we like pictures, too. So if you're out there spotting, you know, send your pictures in. We can make our SKYWARN training local to the area. So I'm not doing the SKYWARN training for Oklahoma. I'm doing it actually for Florida with Florida examples. So it's really that relationship works in the short term and long term.
Okay, excellent. So SKYWARN Recognition Day, though, Saturday, starting evening, Friday evening, and then through the day on Saturday. Big contest-like special event, pile-ups on all the Weather Service offices. Does anybody ever work them all?
I'm sorry,
does anybody
do what? Work them all.
Yeah. Clean sweep?
No, I don't think so. another thing about this, we don't get to use our HF equipment very much, and it turns out last year we didn't make hardly any HF contacts because the antenna had been struck by lightning.
Uh-oh.
And we didn't know that. And so that helped us fix our equipment here in the office. So we're hoping to do much better this year than we did last year.
And you know, looking at the list, Gary, you'd have to be at that mythical Springfield on 2 meters to be able to work them all.
That is true. I guess, yeah, it's probably going to be a little bit too complex to put together a list of the ones you could work, although they could be on Echolink. And, you know,
kind of a good way to not, I don't want to say cheat, but I like the purely, HF route.
Ah, you're one of those. And is Echolink all on one reflector, or is it scattered among a bunch of them?
You just have to look at hamradio.noaa.gov to see who's using Echolink and what their call sign is, and then just give them a call.
Okay. So you got to dig it out. Well, thank you very much, Dan. Appreciate your being with us. I'm going to drop you off the call, and David, hang on for just a second, and we'll wrap up the show. But Dan, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dan.
For the invitation, and it's going to be a great event this year. I hope you all can join us.
Okay,
let me see. Well, we're going to hit you on the air.
Yeah, let me see if I can successfully let go of Dan. Ah, that worked. And we'll promote you to full screen.
All right.
And let's see. Ah, there we go. That works even better.
There you are. Yeah, that fits a little better.
So you're on short time now, I believe. Got to go back to work. It's a work day for you. So we're going to do another one of these pretty quick because you've got an event that you were on just before the Thanksgiving weekend that you've got some details on. And
we had a drill out here, and I'd like to put something together for that statewide hospital drill.
Yeah, and we've got a little bit of wrap up on the Mars attacks. I worked a 60-meter station. Did you?
No, but I don't have any hardware that'll do 60 meters. It's all old school.
Did anybody show up on VHF on the repeaters that day?
You know, I actually, a couple of the nets that I joined in, I actually passed traffic asking for anybody out there, and there wasn't anybody out there.
Interesting. So they'll be disappointed in hearing that, but we want to tell it like it is.
Yeah, absolutely.
And see, there was
a couple other things lined up. So Jamboree on the Air, which I know will work into EmComm, and N6MED from the Red Cross. So that we'll get that up soon, too.
Okay. Plenty to talk about.
Absolutely.
So let me point out Arvin back over my shoulder, the little mascot and the chief financial officer of Ham Radio Now. So stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, And wrong button there. There we go. And if you enjoy the programs, get something out of them, throw, you can join the Patreon. $1 a month would be awesome. But you get, you know, 1,000 or more people doing that. I could retire. Wait a minute. I am retired. I might send money to you. I'm all right. Maybe I'll buy you a microphone.
Well, you know, just help me join you at the next Tapper conference.
That would be cool.
Yeah.
The next one they're thinking is going to be up the coast from you, perhaps in Seattle.
Yeah, I saw that.
That's not for sure, but that's the direction that they're leaning, which would be a long drive for me. And
it'd be a long drive for me too.
Yeah. Not as long for you as for me, but still pretty long drive. You think from out here, I think, you know, all you guys are 100 miles apart. San Francisco's a long drive for you guys.
Yeah. About 5 hours.
So what we need to do is get you a better internet connection so that you spend more than 5% of your time unfrozen.
Yeah. And, you know, unfortunately the timing today, I'm at the office and I'm stuck with their bandwidth here. Do the other ones from the house. I got a much bigger pipe there, better cameras.
Yeah. But you're at a technology company, aren't you?
Yeah.
We won't embarrass them.
Yeah.
Too much more than this. All right. So hamradionow.tv. We got a Facebook group. You could check in on our Facebook group. Look for, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. It's all sitting at the bottom and you can figure all that stuff out. Let me let you go back to work. I will get this episode online so people can actually see it before SKYWARN Recognition Day has started and then ended. So
yeah, that'll be great. And I think it'll be awesome to have folks watching that and drive some traffic towards some of their nets.
Yeah, that would be cool. All right. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now, EmComm Extra Number 4. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
And I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG. Over.
The occasionally moving, it's like one frame every 4 or 5 seconds is what I'm
getting. Is it that bad?
It's pretty bad. Okay, go ahead with the close there.
So over
and out.